it's not getting up in the morning and it's dark and then getting home and it's dark. I don't even mind the occasional snow. Now, what bothers me the most is the mud from the salt on the roads when it gets caked on your vehicle. Now, Dad, I don't need an amen on this one, but a dirty vehicle doesn't bother me all that much. If you've ever noticed, both of our vehicles are kind of dirt colored. They're both brown and tan. And it's not because I particularly like that color, it's just that dirt is camouflaged on a dirt colored vehicle. But that salt from the roads, when it gets on there and turns that gray, crusty white color, I've got to wash that stuff off. And as I was sitting behind the wheel last week and I thought about what my truck was about to go through, I thought of how too many believers tend to think of our conversion experience, the moment that we have come to trust in Jesus, as similar to what my truck was about to go through. A dirty clunker, going in, getting all of that cleansed off, and now it comes out a cleansed clunker. Sadly, too many of us underestimate what happens to us at that moment of conversion. It's more than just that we were cleansed from our sins, but there was a deposit of power given to us. Our golf cart size engines were replaced with 750 horsepower Lamborghini engines bolted to our frames. That's the change that was made in our lives. And a lot of believers that we talk to today, they have the feeling of life as being stuck in a rut, as walking around in circles, being stalled out, monotonous, dull, day in, day out, the same thing over and over again, and it sounds pretty miserable. And if this sounds a little bit too close to home, maybe by taking a look at a similar situation with God's people from Scripture, we can find a way to break through that monotony this morning. According to a study that was done by Reveal Research, this included over 1,000 congregations and 250,000 different church members. 89% of Christians don't feel like they're moving forward in their faith. That means only about 1 in 10 Christians feel driven by their faith. Too many people have the feeling that the Christian life should be more than this, and they live a discouraged life. As we reflect on God's people through Scripture this morning, there was a period of time, roughly about 7 years, where God's people were unstoppable. Every story that you read accounts how they were outnumbered, but they weren't overpowered. And on the timeline of our Bibles, this all took place at the end of the Exodus, after God's people were led out of bondage in Egypt, and now Moses has died. Promised Land was the third stop on their journey. It started there in Egypt. It continued in the wilderness. And this third stop is Canaan. And Canaan is the Promised Land. And if we stop and consider their travel, where they went along the way, each step along their way mirrors what our spiritual lives is like. Each area represents a different condition in life. See, in Egypt, they were in bondage. They were enslaved to Pharaoh. In the wilderness, they were free from Pharaoh, but they were still enslaved to their fears. And then we have the Promised Land. Canaan, they had the opportunity to enter into the land, but they refused. They allowed their fears to hold them back. And because of their disobedience, a journey that should have lasted roughly about 11 months, it wound up taking them 40 years. It was only in Canaan that the people of Israel discovered victory. And it was all recorded later on in the book of Joshua. And it said, "So the Lord gave to Israel all the land he had sworn to give their ancestors." and they took possession of it and settled there. And the Lord gave them rest on every side, just as He had solemnly promised their ancestors. None of their enemies could stand against them, for the Lord helped them conquer all their enemies. Not a single one of all the good promises the Lord had given to the family of Israel was left unfulfilled. Everything He had spoken came true. As we hear those statements, don't they sound amazing? The Lord gave all the land. The Lord gave them rest. None of their enemies could stand against them. All the promises were fulfilled. See, the territory that the Hebrews traveled looks similar to our spiritual journey. Egypt represents our time before we came to know Jesus. We were enslaved to our sin. But then we met our deliverer. And by His grace, we were led to a new life. He broke us free from the old life. He offered us a brand new life. See, our promised land, it's not a physical location like it was for the Hebrews, but it's a life where we are more than conquerors. People who win more often than we lose. People who've been strengthened and refined by our travel along life's journey. We may stumble, but we don't collapse. We might struggle, but we don't despair. See, some people tend to think of Canaan as a metaphor for heaven. But if you think about the land of Canaan in Scripture, when God was describing the promised land, that was a land that was filled with enemies. There was going to be people that Joshua and the Israelites had to conquer. Heaven's not included with enemies. Heaven's free from enemies. So that analogy doesn't really fly. See, Canaan doesn't represent the life to come hereafter. Canaan represents the life that God wants us to have now. And once our deliverer brings us to that brink, He offers us this promised land life. And I hope that each one here this morning can come to see how God invites us to move into Canaan. Promised land life, it's just before us, but it's up to us to make that mental shift from wilderness thinking into promised land thinking. Just think of a world where in that survey, the other 9 individuals left behind that, stagnant, walking in circles, stuck in a rut kind of life, and traded that for the inheritance that's made available to us through Jesus Christ. Once we give our hearts to Christ, God has given Canaan to us. See, everywhere that the Israelites were told to conquer, God had already claimed that land for them. He was just commanding them to follow Him into that land to take it. Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus that He has blessed you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. He has blessed. Not He will bless. Not He might bless. He has blessed. The deed to the promised land life has already been put into our names once we come to know Christ as Savior. But it's up to us to claim it. And by looking at the leadership of Joshua and the Hebrew experiences during this period of time in their history, I want to share a few things that might help to give us that mental shift from the wilderness to the promised land. Out of weak faith into life-giving faith. And I want you to turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, to Joshua, first chapter, and I want to read verses 2 through 9 with you. Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I'm giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I've given you. From the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north. from the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all of the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you be able to prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. God was calling Joshua to lead 2 million people who were once slaves in Egypt into Canaan to inherit all of the land that he had promised their forefathers. What an amazing mission that was. And what word of instruction did God give Joshua in leading these people? Read the Word of God. Don't deviate from the Word of God. The first thing that we must do if we want this promised land life, if we want to turn our backs on wandering in the wilderness and to claim the promised land He has before us, is that we need to spend time in His Word. We need to listen to the Master by reading and studying Scripture. One devotional that I had read, the writer said that it wasn't enough for Joshua to possess the Scriptures. God wanted the Scriptures to possess Joshua. Think about that statement. Are you possessed by the Scriptures, by the Word of God? We must listen to the Master. I remember when our firstborn was just a pup, and yes, our firstborn was a dog. This chocolate lad was the apple of my wife's eye. We came by this dog from the Carters. This dog, Mocha, and her brother had made their way into Kay Mays' flower bed. And that was a no-no. And in order to help this dog escape justice, we took Mocha in. And early on when she was a pup, Hopey was working, and I thought, I'm going to take this dog to just this perfect place for a lab. Had a lot of woods. It had a large lake. Labs love to swim. Now, before I let Mocha off her leash, I gave her a good talking to. All right, I told her to beware. Don't take off running after every squirrel that you hear or deer you might see. Stay with me or you'll get in trouble. I don't know what these woods are like. Stay close by. We'll have fun. Well, what do you think the first thing she did as soon as I let her off that leash? She bolted. She saw something across the lake. She took off. I could still see her across there as I was telling her to come back. And she would look at me and look back at the squirrel she was chasing. Look at me back and forth until eventually she took off running. Now, after I got past the thoughts of how Hobie was going to kill me for losing her firstborn, I composed myself, took off into the woods, found her about 45 minutes later. She had this hangdog look on her face. She was covered with cockle burrs and thorns, and it was like she was looking at me saying, "You were right. I should have listened." We have to listen to the Master. At one point early on, while the Israelites were marching through the territory, which God had already claimed for them, Joshua called all the people together. Now, he called them all together not to celebrate their recent wins in battle, not to celebrate their accomplishments. He called all of these people to come together to read the Word of God. He positioned himself in a valley where they could all hear the instructions from God. Joshua 8 said that there wasn't a word of all that Moses had commanded, which Joshua didn't read them. Now keep in mind that this was all in the middle of an invasion. All the enemies knew that the Israelites were marching through. Yet Joshua had called them all together to spend time in God's Word. Heeding God's Word is more critical than fighting God's war. Do you want a promised land life? Then listen to the Master. Second vital step to live in the promised land life is to remember whose we are. Before coming into the promised land of Canaan, the Israelites had to cross the Jordan River. Now, this was in the springtime. The Jordan River would have been overflowing its banks about a mile wide across. It was a raging river because of the snows from Mount Hebron that had melted. God commanded this to be crossed. Every man, woman, and child, old, young, sick, disabled, all these 2 million people crossing over this river. And we read how God stopped the flow of the river, and everyone crossed on dry land. And once they got safely to the other side, God commanded 12 individuals, a man from each tribe, to go into the riverbed to get a stone. And Joshua took those stones and carefully stacked them up. And he explained to them why they were doing this. He said, when your children ask their fathers in time to come, why are these stones here? And you shall let them know how your Lord dried up the water so his people could cross on dry land. Once again, all of this was in enemy territory. The secret to living a promised land life is that when the enemy seems to surround us, we remember. It's similar to the way that a parent might talk to their child who's just graduated and now they're moving off. And the parent looks at the child and says, remember what I've taught you. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. You belong to us. Junior year in college was difficult for me. There was a lot of stress. I remember this conversation like it was yesterday. I was talking with Dad, and I was going through this long list of all the things that were stressing me out and all the things that weren't fair. And Dad patiently waited for my tirade to come to an end. And he spoke to me, and it was one by one a reminder of all the ways that God had blessed me. One by one, he laid out for me the life that God had made possible for me up to that point. And the conversation was ended by saying, okay, we agree that God has done all of these amazing things for us. What makes us think that he won't continue these things? Remember whose we are. Historians talk about the formidable walls of Jericho. We learn those songs early on in church. Successive walls. The outer wall was 7 feet thick, 16 feet high. On top of that wall was another 8 foot high wall. It was protected by steep hills on the sides. It was an imposing figure across the plains. Any enemy that would try to come up, they would see Jericho from a distance. It stood between the Israelites and Canaan, their promised land. And each of us have a challenge that is facing us that is like that Jericho. Every one of us has a Jericho standing in the way between us and God's promises for us. And like Joshua, we don't have to face Jericho alone. Jericho was a stronghold in Canaan. Fortified place. It was protected against attacks. And we all face strongholds in our lives. Paul describes spiritual strongholds as a mindset or an attitude that tries to exalt itself against the knowledge of God. It attempts to magnify the problem and minimize God's ability to solve it. Think over your strongholds. Mindset that might say, I can't forgive that person. I'll never recover. I'll never succeed. I'm a failure. I have to look a certain way or be a certain person before people will like me. Spiritual strongholds. that tries to magnify the problem and minimize God's ability to solve it. When the Israelites approached, they were commanded to have the soldiers go before and after the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant represented God's presence. God was telling them to keep His presence in their center. If you want to march against your strongholds victoriously, remember whose you are and keep God in the center. Spend time listening to the Master by reading His Word. Remember whose you are. The third thing that I wish to share with you about living a promised land life is to trust God's promises. Sadly, we live in a world of broken promises, don't we? We live in a world of failed commitments. Many people find it difficult to trust anyone, much less trust God and His promises. But our God is a covenant-keeping God. My boys, Sam and Clay, they have minds that are like steel traps. In a moment of weakness, if I tell them that I'll take them to Walmart to let them look at toys, they remember that. For days. If I tell them that I'll take them to a movie that they've been wanting to see, they remember that. And they'll say, "But Dad said." "But Dad said." Or if their Nana B tells them they'll take them somewhere and it doesn't sound quite right and I try to tell them otherwise, they're like, "No, but Nana B said. She said this." If we would just hold on to God's promises the way that my boys would hold on to my promises. When fears show up, respond by saying, "But God said." When doubts arise, "But God said." When guilt overwhelms you, "But God said." People who have a promised land life, they choose to trust that God is up to something good even when all they see around them looks bad. They choose to trust God's promises. God promised Abraham that He would bless him. If you refer back to those verses I read earlier, it says, not a single one of all the good promises the Lord had given to the family of Israel was left unfulfilled. Everything He had spoken had come true. When all others fail you, God never will. Our God is a promise-keeping God. Some of our old hymns are even more powerful when you just read the lyrics. And I appreciate what Dean did earlier with that powerful song as he read those. Sometimes we tend to sing these songs out of memory and we get lost on the lyrics. But as I think about God's promises, words from the hymn, "The Solid Rock," come to mind. His oath, His covenant, His blood support me in the whelming flood. Promised land living requires that we trust God's promises. Promises like, "I'll be with you." Promises like, "I'll never leave you." Promises that say, "I go and I prepare a place for you. I will deliver you. My grace is sufficient for you." These promises sustain and empower us to move forward in our faith. Now, before you go away from this message thinking that, wait a minute, this sounds like that prosperity preaching that is going on all around us where they say that faith will increase your monetary and your possessions. Hear me out. God's promise of prosperity may occasionally include money, but it most often refers to a wealthy mind, spirit, and body. Choose to listen to the Master. Remember whose you are. Choose to trust His promises, and you'll be blessed. It may not be in the way that you think, but maybe you'll be blessed with a clear conscience. You'll be blessed with a good night's sleep. Be blessed with His fellowship. You'll be blessed with God's favor. Canaan represents the victorious Christian life for us. The wilderness represents the defeated Christian life. See, the people were free from bondage, but they refused to claim the land that God had for them. The choice is ours. If you're here today and you have never made that decision to put your life in the hands of the deliverer, and you still find yourself enslaved to the sin that is all around you, would you come today? It's not a promise of an easy life, but it is a promise of God's help. If you're here today and you're a believer and you feel like you've been stuck in the rut, you're walking in circles, you're not moving forward in your faith, claim the land that God has already chosen for you. Press forward into that promised land life. If you're here this morning and you have no church family, you have no church home, I would encourage you to come join this body of believers as we march into the promised land together, side by side. Come talk. I would love to have that opportunity this morning. Whatever decision God is laying on your heart, would you come this morning as we sing together? Thank you.